हेलो माय डियर फ्रेंड्स, हाउ आर यू ऑल? आई थिंक यू एंड मी, ऑल ऑफ अस आर डूइंग आवर बेस्ट सो दैट वी कैन सर्वाइव एंड वी आर स्टिल सर्वाइविंग, राइट? दैट मीन्स वी आर समहाउ सक्सेसफुल इन आवर वे टू पुट आवर 100% टू गेट द बेस्ट आउट ऑफ अस इन दिस क्राइसिस पीरियड. सो लेट्स हैव अ लिटिल leisure time where we can hear, where we can go back to our childhood. So all those my little friends, along with us, let's start the next story, The Boy with the Moon on His Forehead. This story is taken from Folk Tales of Bengal, written by Reverend Lal Bihari Dey. The first edition of this book was published in the year 1883. And this very book was published in the year 1912. So let's start the next story, The Boy with the Moon on His Forehead. There was a certain king who had 6 queens, none of whom bore children. Physicians, holy sages, medicaments were consulted, countless drugs were had recourse to, but all to no purpose. The king was disconsolate. His ministers told him to marry a 7th wife, and he was accordingly on the lookout. In the royal city, there lived a poor old woman who used to pick up cow dung from the fields, make it into cakes, dry them in the sun, and sell them in the market for fuel. This was her only means of subsistence. This old woman had a daughter exquisitely beautiful. Her beauty excited the admiration of everyone that saw her, and it was solely in consequence of her surpassing beauty that 3 young ladies far above her in rank and station contracted friendship with her. Those 3 young ladies were the daughter of the king's minister, the daughter of a wealthy merchant, and the daughter of the royal priest. These 3 young ladies, together with the daughter of the poor old woman, were one day bathing in a tank not far from the palace. As they were performing their ablutions, each dwelt on her own good qualities. "Look here, sister," said the minister's daughter, addressing the merchant's daughter, "the man that marries me will be a happy man, for he will not have to buy clothes for me. The clothes which I once put on never get soiled, never gets old, never tears." The merchant's daughter said, "And my husband too will be a happy man, for the fuel which I use in cooking never gets turned into ashes. The same fuel serves from day to day, from year to year." "And my husband will also become a happy man," said the daughter of the royal chaplain, "for the rice which I cook one day never gets finished, and when we have all eaten, the same quantity which was first cooked remains always in the pot." The daughter of the poor old woman said in her turn, "And the man that marries me will also be happy, for I shall give birth to 2 children, a son and a daughter. The daughter will be divinely fair, and the son will have the moon on his forehead and stars on the palms of his hands." The above conversation was overheard by the king, who, as he was on the lookout for a 7th queen, used to skulk about in places where women met together. The king thus thought in his mind, "I don't care a straw for the girl whose clothes never tear and never get old. Neither do I care for the other girl whose fuel is never consumed, nor for the 3rd girl whose rice never fails in the pot. But the 4th girl is quite charming. She will give birth to 2 children, a son and a daughter. The daughter will be divinely fair, and the son will have the moon on his forehead and stars on the palms of his hands. That is the girl I want." I will make her my wife. On making inquiries on the same day, the king found that the fourth girl was the daughter of a poor old woman who picked up cow dung from the fields. But though there was thus an infinite disparity in rank, he determined to marry her. On the very same day, he sent for the poor old woman. She, poor thing, was quite frightened when she saw a messenger of the king standing at the door of her hut. She thought that the king had sent for her to punish her because perhaps she had some day unwittingly picked up the dung of the king's cattle. She went to the palace and was admitted into the king's private chamber. The king asked her whether she had a very fair daughter, and whether that daughter was the friend of his own ministers and priests' daughters. When the woman answered in the affirmative, he said to her, "I will marry your daughter and make her my queen." The woman hardly believed her own ears. The thing was so strange. He, however, solemnly declared to her that he had made up his mind and was determined to marry her daughter. It was soon known in the capital that the king was going to marry the daughter of the old woman who picked up cow dung in the fields. When the six queens heard the news, they would not believe it, till the king himself told them that the news was true. They thought that the king had somehow got mad. They reasoned with him thus: "What folly, what madness, to marry a girl who is not fit to be our maid servant, and you expect us to treat her as our equal? A girl whose mother goes about picking up cow dung in the fields? Surely, my lord, you are beside yourself." The king's purpose, however, remained unshaken. The royal astrologer was called, and an auspicious day was fixed for the celebration of the king's marriage. On the appointed day, the royal priest tied the marital knot, and the daughter of the poor old picker up of cow dung in the fields became the seventh and best beloved queen. Sometime after the celebration of the marriage, the king went for 6 months to another part of his dominions. Before setting out, he called to him the seventh queen and said to her, "I am going away to another part of my dominions for 6 months. Before the expiration of that period, I expect you to be confined, but I should like to be present with you at the time, as your enemies may do mischief. Take this golden bell and hang it in your room. When the pains of childbirth come upon you, ring this bell, and I will be with you in a moment in whatever part of my dominions I may be at the time. Remember, you are to ring the bell only when you feel the pains of childbirth." After saying this, the king started on his journey. The six queens, who had overheard the king, went on the next day to the apartments of the seventh queen and said, "What a nice bale of the gold you have got, sister. Where did you get it, and why have you hung it up?" The seventh queen, in her simplicity, said, "The king has given it to me, and if I were to ring it, the king would immediately come to me, wherever he might be at the time." "Impossible," said the six queens. "You must have misunderstood the king. Who can believe that this bell can be heard at the distance of hundreds of miles? Besides, if it would be heard, how would the king be able to travel a great distance in the twinkling of an eye? This must be a hoax. If you ring the bell, you will find that what the king said was pure nonsense." The six queens then told her to make a trial. At first, she was unwilling, remembering what the king had told her. but at last she was prevailed upon to ring the bell. The king was at the moment halfway to the capital of his other dominions, but at the ringing of the bell he stopped short in his journey, turned back, and in no time stood in the queen's apartments. Finding the queen going about in her room, he asked why she had rung the bell, though her hour had not come. She, without informing the king of the entreaty of the six queens, replied that she rang the bell only to see whether what he had said was true. The king was somehow indignant, told her distinctly not to ring the bell again till the moment of the coming up of her of the pains of childbirth, and then went away. So, my dear friends, today we are going to stop here, and tomorrow we will dig in what happened next, whether our queen, the seventh queen, rang the bell again not as per the instruction or not, we will come to know tomorrow. Till then, be safe, be happy, be jolly. Shubhamastu.